this point, I would like to talk to you about how we, that means you and I, can help in plastic waste management, and why is it important for government to support the waste management programs, given that the plastics, when outside of our households, become a public bad. So we have public goods and public bads, right, economists? Now, government just looks at public goods, but I think it's important that government also looks at public bads. So my talk will be about the challenges in governance and implementation of the solid waste management programs and focus on plastics. Earlier this morning, a national scientist, Dr. Domingo, has said that enacting the law is a walk in the park, but implementation is something else. For this particular topic, implementation is a walk towards the highest peak of the mountain. So very, very challenging one. All right, so there are four parts to this presentation. First, I would just like to briefly talk about the legal basis for our solid waste management programs, which is the Philippines RA 9003. Then I will describe the institutional mechanisms that are inside that law. And then I would look at the progress in the local level implementation of the law as gathered from data from secondary sources. And I would also like to give you a model for institutional innovation for sustainable solid waste management, which was a case study that was funded by the UP Systems Emerging Interdisciplinary Program. Okay. So, what is this RA 9003 all about? This was earlier mentioned, but the passage of this law, which is the Ecological Solid Waste Management Act in 2001, was considered a landmark policy because of its integrated approach to solid waste management. All right, so here are some of the provisions of the RA 9003, which we can actually monitor. So first, it provides for the mandatory segregation of waste at the household level, with collection vehicles having the appropriate compartments for the sorted wastes. So of course, I don't think any local government unit can afford having a vehicle with appropriate compartments of biodegradable and non-biodegradable waste, right? Second, the law also mandates the establishment of recycling centers, or what we call MRFs, at every barangay nationwide. And as will be seen later, this has a very, very low score. And the first, the reason for this is that the barangays wouldn't make this a priority. Therefore, they will not have the money for this. Third, the law requires the preparation of a 10-year solid waste management plans by all local government units. Again, very low score. And the fourth is that the law allows for the creation of a municipal and provincial solid waste management boards with corresponding functions. All right. So, there was a public consultation, national consultation, when the framework was established, and here were some of the issues raised during those consultations. One, that some relevant agencies, such as the Department of Education, are not members of the National Solid Waste Management Council, and that the 10-year program seems to be not a really long-term solid waste management plan at the local level, and there is no room for private sector participation in the law, and that there's no database management provisions that can help synchronize solid waste management at all levels. Okay, for the institutional mechanisms, so the law provides for these particular governing boards at all levels. At the national level, we have the National Solid Waste Management Committee under the office of the president, but the person responsible is the DNR secretary. And that committee is supposed to prepare the National Solid Waste Management Framework. And then there's this most important center called the National Ecology Center, where the Environmental Management Bureau Director heads. Among the responsibilities are to establish and manage a solid waste management information database in coordination with other agencies. And I visited this National Ecology Center, and well, it has a lot of problems. There's also a solid waste management board headed by the governor, the city and municipal solid waste management board headed by the mayors, as well as the barangay solid waste management committee headed by the barangay captains. So all of these boards have their own set of responsibilities. All right. So another ideal institution that is in the law is the Regional Ecology Center. And this should be headed by the EMB regional director in ex officio capacity. Okay. Such center has the following, amongst the responsibilities are the following: shall maintain a multi-sectoral, a multidisciplinary pool of experts, including those from the academe, the business and industry, practicing professionals, youth, women, and other concerned sectors. And to facilitate training and education on integrated solid waste management. However, I don't know of a region that has an active regional ecology center. Some of the challenges of the current institutional mechanisms, earlier we had challenges of the law. Here is the institutional mechanisms: no budget, no personnel. So that's true for the National Ecology Center as well as the Regional Ecology Center. No organizational structure for the NEC at the EMB. And also the current institutional arrangement does not allow for the establishment of the NSWM funds. So that is why implementation at best is very weak. Okay. So these are very dated data, but I would just like to show you that the blue lines are created boards, the red lines are the active boards. So what you see here, and this is the city and municipal solid waste management boards, that there are more created boards than active boards. So there seems to be no sustainability in the board's existence. So this is for the city and the municipal solid waste. The barangay solid waste management committees are even worse. So there are creations of the committee, but except for CAR, which is of course a bit also questionable, there is not a lot of active barangay level committees. And this is 2010, so I was trying to look for a more recent data, but the National Ecology Center cannot give me one. So this is just my analysis of the trends, that there are more provincial and city and municipal level boards that are active. However, at the barangay level, which is supposed to be the most important, the most strategic level of solid waste management programs, there are very few active barangay level committees. And therefore, there are a lot of sustainability challenges. Okay, sustainability because, number one, maybe there is no platform for such programs, solid waste management. Second, no capacities, especially at the barangay level. And third, of course, no funds. Okay. So let me share with you the progress in the local level implementation of the law, again, as I gathered from secondary sources. This one is from the Senate Committee, 2017. So in terms of collection, 85% in Metro Manila, but only about 40% outside of Metro Manila. So these are the local governments that have collection programs. Waste disposal, 2017 data, open dumping is still popular. Controlled dump sites and sanitary landfills are limited. The diversion and recovery, so 31% only of all barangays in the country have the materials recovery facilities. For local boards, so as of 2017, only 68% have provincial boards, 38% have municipal or city boards, and 13% have committee or barangay committees. And remember, the law provides for a plan, solid waste management plan. So again, as of September 2017, while there were about 1,500 plans submitted to the EMP, only about 20% of the plans have been approved. And here are some more challenges in the RA 9003 implementation, again from secondary sources. And this validates our observation that capacity building and understanding the provisions of the law and in formulating the solid waste management plans are still lacking. Fund generation is needed. Too many members of the board. Unclear delineation of the various members in the provincial board. And of course, the lack of enforcement of ordinances that should have supported the solid waste management activities. All right. So for the remaining time, I would like to share with you our experience in an institutional innovation of sustainable solid waste management. Okay? And as I said, this was a project of UP system through the EIDR, and one of the activities of the water governance project. So the ecosystem or the resource is water. And we tested a model that is called adaptive collaborative water governance in the watershed of Santa Cruz River in Laguna in order to see whether such can provide for sustainability in terms of solid waste management, focusing, of course, on plastics. So by the way, plastics is about 11% of the total solid waste gathered in households and institutions here in the Philippines. So what do we mean by adaptive collaborative water governance? So this is an approach to the governance of the social ecological systems. So we're not just talking of the natural systems, but also especially of the social systems in which groups of actors purposefully base their decision-making on social learning and critical reflection, emphasizes inclusion and equity, and strive for the balance and strategic collaboration with the other actors. Okay, so there are a lot of keywords there, but adaptive collaborative governance has been tested, especially in Africa, in the context of gender as well as forest resource management. So this particular approach has four stages, okay, and this is the protocol. So first is you need to build partnerships as well as assess initial conditions. Okay. Second, you need to have planning strategic actions, but this is planning together with the stakeholders. So we academics, we usually would just get hired as consultants in order to come up with some plans, local government plans. But for this particular purpose, what we did was to engage the locals, the local government, the community members, the barangay capitans, etc., in planning strategic action so that they will be the ones to really understand what the problem is or what the problems are. Remember, we went into this particular study site looking at water, but in the end, the stakeholders there said that they need solid waste management activities. And the third is to help the stakeholders develop their own solid waste management plan, as well as now implement an investment plan, again, together with the stakeholders. So Academ was able to facilitate each and every stage of this protocol. So this is just our the description of our study site. So what I'd like to point out are the major actors. So there is a platform, there has to be a platform, okay? So it's the River Council in this particular example. The River Council consists of local government officials who are not elected, councilors, so they're elected, as well as the technical personnel within the municipalities and the barangay capitan, and there are civil society. So this is an inclusive group. Anyone who wants to be part of the council is welcome. So for this particular sub-watershed, there are 6 municipalities, and the Laguna Lake Development Authority, of course, is a part, because Santa Cruz watershed, the one in yellow, drains to the Laguna Lake. Okay? And the Santa Cruz River is one of the major tributaries going to Laguna Lake. And the other major partner is the provincial and the community environment and natural resources offices. And of course, the Academ served as the facilitator. All right, so what we did is we just followed the methodological framework. It's circular because it's adaptive, right? And it's social learning. Okay, so, but for this particular study, we started from scratch. We taught them how to write the minutes of the meeting. We taught them how to be prompt in going to the meetings, et cetera, et cetera. And we taught them all of these things that we do in the Academ. And of course, they appreciated that one. So there were monthly meetings, there are forums, training workshops. And so this is a capacity building, but capacity building that has gone in an expanded period of time. So it's not just a one-shot deal. So the first step was partnership building, and our project was lucky because there was already that River Council that was organized by another project within the LLDA. However, that River Council was a very loose organization, and it was not really it did not have any vision or mission, etc. So they were not redirected. But when we came in, we in a strategic planning exercise, we asked them to state their own vision and mission statements. And we also asked them to understand what their problem is and what they would like their Santa Cruz River system to be. And they said, yes, this river needs to be rehabilitated, but how to do this? And so part of what has to be done is, and that was based on their own agreement, was proper disposal and management of garbage. So from here, and these are all about garbage, human waste, animal waste, non-use or controlled use of chemical fertilizers and pesticides, which are still waste. So to them, this was the most important and the most critical problem that needs to be looked at in order for them to rehabilitate the river. Next slide, please. So this is just Okay, that last slide was just a validation of some national level data that we had. So we engaged with the stakeholders. This is now the third stage in the protocol. The Water Resource Management Plan done in 2017. And for them, their priority was solid waste management. What the other thing that they did was to propose for an investment plan for them to help solve this water or solid waste management. All right, so some activities that the platform, the River Council did was to have those monthly meetings. Participation had been transparent and inclusive, and River Council, as they said, continuously gained knowledge about the watershed now. So it's not just the water, it's not just the waste, but it's also the watershed and the challenges. There are other rules of engagement. See, participation is voluntary. Okay? Sometimes they just contribute so that they will have snacks, so they don't need funding to go to the meetings because they realize that what they're doing is important for the community. So participation is voluntary, but they try to keep the municipality's participation regularly because they need the LGUs actually to frame ordinances, promote good practices of municipalities. So right now, there is this private sector partnership with the River Council where a cement factory gathers their waste regularly so that, that's how they would like to lessen the volume of solid waste in their municipalities, at the same time generating funds. So what are the outcomes so far? So the project started in 2012 and it lasted until 2017. We are now 2019, we are still attending the meetings, the monthly meetings of the River Council. But so these outcomes need to be studied some more, express it into data, because these are some. Number one, for instance, is a perception, but they have started actually to gather data, weighing the plastics that they get from the river downstream and from the municipalities upstream. So they reduce solid waste management according to the representatives from the Santa Cruz municipality. And there is a sustained partnership, and there is emerging and hopefully a productive partnership with a private cement factory who gathers plastic waste and who also offers incentives. So in conclusions, again, the law must be implemented by building capacities at the local level, providing necessary funds, and creating a platform. Sustainability of our solid waste management plan's implementation really depends on the commitments of the local institutions, the community members, the local governments, as well as you and me, the household members, to change our behavior as well. And we have some recommendations. Okay, so institutional strengthening through the HCG is needed to sustain the solid waste management activities. So this is a model that we have tested, and it has worked. So maybe this can also work in some river basins in other parts of the lake of Laguna, Dubai, as well as in other lakes in the country. Solid waste management plans should be crafted in a participatory manner and focused on achieving incentives, should keep the spirit of collaboration always active. Leadership is an important factor for a committed river council. So again, this particular council had a very good leader. And the academe attention, we have a very important role to play in all of these things. Maraming salamat po.